Good evening, St. Matthews. Welcome to evening prayer for Wednesday, the 29th of July. And welcome to everyone else who joins us from different communities and different parts of the world. Today, as a church, we've been thinking of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And what it reminds me of is Jesus is interested in relationships. He's interested in community. And I love thinking about the times when Jesus just sat down with Mary and Martha and Lazarus and chatted away with them. He ate with them and he also wept with them. So no matter what your day has held for you so far, we come now to that same Jesus who journeys with us, who stays with us in whatever space we find ourselves in. And he asks us to think about who we are and what we do. He asks us to be a little bit like Mary and a little bit like Martha. And as we come into evening prayer this evening, let's take on that role that Mary did when she sat at his feet. The readings for us today are from Psalm 11 and 2 Corinthians chapter 12. So as we pause to center ourselves and give this time over to God, I'll just read a couple of lines from Psalm 11. When the foundations are destroyed, what do you do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. So let's bring him everything that our day, our lives hold at this moment, and know that he is in heaven. So if you want to join me on page 155, and that's evening prayer for Wednesday. O God, make speed to save us. O Lord, make haste to help us. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my crag, my fortress, and my deliverer. In my distress, I called upon the Lord and cried out to my God for help. He heard my voice in his temple, and my cry came to his ears. He parted the heavens and came down, and thick darkness was under his feet. He rode upon the cherubim and flew. He came flying on the wings of the wind. He made darkness his covering round about him, dark waters and thick clouds his pavilion. From the brightness of his presence, through the clouds, burst hailstones and coals of fire. The Lord also thundered out of heaven. The Most High uttered his voice with hailstones and coals of fire. For you will save a lowly people and bring down the high looks of the proud. You also shall light my candle. The Lord my God shall make my darkness to be bright. As for God, his way is perfect. The word of the Lord is tried in the fire. He is a shield to all who trust in him. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. That this evening may be holy, good, and peaceful, let us pray with one heart and mind. As our evening prayer rises before you, O God, so may your mercy come down upon us to cleanse our hearts and set us free to sing your praise now and forever. Amen. So we turn now to God's word. And the psalm for today is Psalm 11. It's on page 662 in the daily prayer books. The Lord's throne is in heaven. In the Lord have I taken refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to the hills? For see how the wicked bend the bow and fit their arrows to the string, to shoot from the shadows at the true of heart. When the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try every mortal being. The Lord tries the righteous as well as the wicked. But those who delight in violence, his soul abhors. Upon the wicked, he shall rain coals of fire and burning sulfur. Scorching wind shall be their portion to drink. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. And those who are upright shall behold his face. The Lord's throne is in heaven. God of heaven, when the foundations are shaken and there is no escape, test us, but not to destruction. Look on the face of your anointed and heal us in Jesus Christ, your Son. Amen. So we turn now to our New Testament reading, and it is Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, and we will be reading chapter 12. It's on page 182 in the Church Bibles. It is necessary to boast. Nothing is to be gained by it, but I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a person in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that such a person, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, was caught up into paradise and heard things that are not to be told, that no mortal is permitted to repeat. On behalf of such a one, I will boast. But on my own behalf, I will not boast, except of my weaknesses. But if I wish to boast, I will not be a fool, for I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think better of me than what is seen in me or heard from me, even considering the exceptional character of the revelations. Therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given to me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I appealed to the Lord about this, that it would leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. So I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. Therefore I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities for the sake of Christ. For whenever I am weak, then I am strong. I have been a fool. You forced me to it. Indeed, you should have been the ones commending me. For I am not at all inferior to these super apostles, even though I am nothing. The signs of a true apostle were performed among you with utmost patience, signs and wonders and mighty works. How have you been worse off than the other churches, except that I myself did not burden you? Forgive me this wrong. Here I am, ready to come to you this third time, and I will not be a burden, because I do not want what is yours, but you. For children ought not to lay up for their parents, but parents for their children. I will most gladly spend and be spent for you. If I love you more, am I to be loved less? let it be assumed that I did not burden you. Nevertheless, you say, since I was crafty, I took you in by deceit. Did I take advantage of you through any of those whom I sent to you? I urged Titus to go and sent the brother with him. Titus did not take advantage of you, did he? Did we not conduct ourselves with the same spirit? Did we not take the same steps? Have you been thinking all along that we have been defending ourselves before you? We are speaking in Christ before God. Everything we do, beloved, is for the sake of building you up. For I fear that when I come, I may find you not as I wish, and that you may find me not as you wish. I fear that there may perhaps be quarreling, jealousy, anger, selfishness, slander, gossip, conceit, and disorder. I fear that when I come again, my God may humble me before you, and that I may have to mourn over many who previously sinned and have not repented of the impurity, sexual immorality, and licentiousness that they have practiced. Wow, don't you just love Paul and his writings? Not always straightforward. And there's a lot in there for us to dwell on. Definitely not easy. You'll even find Peter in his letters talking about the fact that Paul isn't easy to understand. But you know what? It invites us to study God's word, because there are nuggets in there. And today, if I can just get us to reflect on what Paul speaks about the thorn in his flesh. What is the thorn in your flesh? I know I am oft aware of the thorn in my flesh. And Paul reminds us that he asked God 3 times, maybe more, to take that flesh away from him. How many times have you and I asked God to take away the thorn in our flesh? But the way God responded to Paul is the same way he responds to us. When he says that his grace is sufficient for us, and that his power is made perfect in our weakness. So as we turn to a time of prayer, like Paul said, weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. Let's bring them all to Jesus, and let's turn to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening knowing that you are on the throne. Father, we thank you that you are God. We thank you that you are the one who redeems us and sustains us. So, Father, we ask this evening that as we sit at your feet, you will give us wisdom. You will give us discernment. You will make us aware of your grace and your power that is made perfect in our weakness. Father, and as we look at that list that Paul offers us, we think of the calamities and the hardships and the persecution in this world that we live in. Father, we ask for your mercy. We ask for your grace. We ask for your power to be made perfect in the weakness that the world finds itself in. Father, as this pandemic continues, as new spikes appear in different parts of the world. Father, just like we heard on the news earlier today, that only in the last few days, 7 children have died in a hospital in Zimbabwe just because there weren't enough staff who've been off sick due to the virus. So Father, in small ways and big, this virus continues. And Father, we pray for all those who continue to battle against it. Father, we pray for science and for research. And Father, we pray that in the name of Jesus, this world will soon know the release that you bring. And as we wait, oh Father, we ask for your grace. Father, we ask for your grace for our communities. Our communities here at church, in our places of work, in the different circles you have placed us in. And Father, just like you spent time with Mary and Martha and Lazarus, Father, we pray that we will spend time with the people in our communities, virtually as it may be, as of now. But Father, that we will journey with the people you place in our lives, and that we will continue to be signs of your grace and your mercy. Father, that we will build each other up. Father, we pray for our families. We pray for our lives. We pray about the thorn in our flesh. And Father, we thank you for these opportunities that we can look to you. We can be reminded of our need of you, our dependence on you. So Father, even as we pause right now, Father, we pray that you will bring to mind. And Father, even as we offer you the thorns in our flesh, we pray that you will take these and that you will cover them with your grace. So hear these words that Jesus said to Paul, and he says to you and me, as we offer him these thorns. When he says, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Heavenly Father, we thank you that your everlasting arms are big enough and wide enough to carry our world, our country, the people in our hearts, and even us with the thorns in our flesh. Hear our prayer, for we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So as we continue in a time of prayer and worship, just stay there at his feet. And as we listen to this song, it's called Blessings. One of the lines in the song says, what if the trials of this world are your mercies in disguise? Let's worship.
We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken need, yet love is way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life all your mercies in disguise. We pray for wisdom, your voice to hear, and we cry in anger when we cannot feel you near. We doubt your goodness, we doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, and long that we'd have faith to what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? And what if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? And what if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise?
So our collect for this evening: God our Father, whose Son enjoyed the love of his friends, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, in learning, argument, and hospitality, may we so rejoice in your love that the world may come to know the depths of your wisdom, the wonder of your compassion, and your power to bring life out of death. Through the merits of Jesus Christ, our friend and brother, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So let's say the grace. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. That concludes evening prayer for Wednesday. it's been lovely to pause here in our chapel and to spend time in God's presence and to know that even though we can't meet in person, we are together as a community. So let's hold on to those promises that we find in Paul's letter to the Corinthians and that verse that we started with. When the foundations are destroyed, what do you and I do? Let's remember that the Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. Have a lovely evening. God bless you.